Hello students, welcome to the class on answer writing, and in this class I will be dealing with the answers to the questions that I had uploaded on brainiki.com on 30th of October. Now the first question was, analyze World Bank's projection about India. Now World Bank has projected that the India will be finding it very difficult to have a growth rate of beyond 8%. Now this was something, this is the main news about Indian economy. Now how you should be analyzing this? First of all, you should be analyzing about the positive things, that what are the opportunities for India to cross this 8%, and what are the disputations on the way of Indian economy to achieve this target of beyond 8%. So frankly, you should not be writing about whatever is contained in that report. Rather, you should be writing from your own ingenuity about the positives and the negatives of the Indian economy that you have read about fiscal deficit, about current account deficit, about our trade, about inflation, about the productivity of the Indian economy, about the strengthening of the different sectors, like of the software sector, of the manufacturing sector, and of the agriculture sector. Now all the students, they have not written it in this manner. What they have written is whatever the World Bank has talked about. They have just cut, copy pasted the news item from the Hindu to write the answer. So they have just written about the reforms that needs to be done, like we are having so many reforms pending and we need to fasten those reforms, and then they have written about how we need to strengthen the local governance. Now World Bank's report should look timid in front of your own analysis. That is the purpose of civil services preparation. Now even the paper checker would be expecting your answer to be more heavier than the analysis that was done by World Bank's report. So the second question is, Nepal is Modi government's biggest foreign policy blunder, comment. Now such type of questions, they require a kind of in-depth analysis. They should not be a superficial and a superficial analysis. Now how an in-depth analysis can be done? Now in-depth analysis can be done if you are connecting it to the past of the Indian foreign policy, and if you are connecting it to the future of the Indian policy, and then by using the past and the future goalpost that you have set up, you are guiding your present action. So such should be the introduction. Then the blunder that the Indian policy has done. Now why it is a blunder? It is a blunder because it is an aberration. It is a kind of a deviation. It is a kind of a change that we have introduced. Now what kind of a change we have introduced? Change in terms of, earlier we were not following such kind of policies. We were not imposing economic embargo on somebody. We were not imposing economic aggression. We have always believed in Panchsheel. We have always believed in NAM principles, and those principles restrict the economic aggression. But this is an act of economic aggression, and whenever you will do some economic aggression, the other party will side with your adversaries. And this is what the Nepal has done in case of India restricting the oil movement to Nepal. Now this is a blunder. This will give a lot of leverage. This will give a lot of opportunity. This will increase the maneuverability of China in Nepal. And the China's movement towards South Asia will intensify. Already China is coming up with n number of projects, OR, OP, and like CPEC, and then it's concirclement and containment policy. You could have used all those things. Now when you are looking at a blunder, it should be looked in a global perspective, India's image. Nobody has written these things. What lessons should India learn from China's demographic strain? Now what kind of a lesson we learn from this demographic strain? Now the first lesson is that we should be learning that we should not be controlling the population the way China has controlled, because if we will do that, we will be at the same position, we will be facing the same problem, we will be facing the same dilemma, we will be in a same quandary in which China currently is. So in order to avoid that kind of a quandary, we should not be following that restrictive and strict population policy. Then another lesson that India should be learning is rather we should learn to manage the population. Now why China had restricted their population? Because they were not able to manage it. It was increasing at a stupendous price. The agriculture productivity was less. It was taking a heavy toll. The dependency population was very high. When you have a young people, they are actually dependent. When you have poor people, the elder people, they are again dependent. But as this is the reality of a demographic transition. You cannot do away with this reality of demographic transition. Every country is passing through a certain phase of demographic transition. And every phase of the demographic transition has got with itself the problems, the positives and the negatives. Now, the phase in which the China is, India would also be moving into that phase. But we must learn from their mistakes. Now, another third lesson that we could learn is how to manage the elderly population. India will be getting older later on than China is getting. So whatever policies and programs they will be applying, they will be implementing for the elderly, India should also keep an eye on those plans and programs so that we can design our own, we can manage the poor population in the days to come. Nobody has written it. Then let's critically analyze the French Revolution. I won't be telling you the answer. A guy has written a very good answer on it. And you must read his answer. That's, I think, the perfect answer. That is Lola's answer. You must read his answer. It's a perfect answer. Then internet surveillance is on rise. Is it justified? Write about ethics and rights perspective. Now, internet surveillance is on rise. Is it justified? It is justified to a point. It is justified till a limit. It is justified till a certain standard. A standard which helps in protecting the cyber security, which helps in protecting us, which helps in providing a shield, a coverage from the cyber attacks, from the e-attacks. But it is not justified beyond this, which actually can indulge in the issue of privacy. And surveillance is also justified if you are transgressing into somebody's privacy to protect a bigger whole. So this should have been the approach of the answers. Two approaches, some guy had asked me on the website, what should be the approach? Two approaches, deontological and consequential, both approaches, this approach should be used. And the first approach is the balance should be maintained between the individual's right and providing the security to the people. So this was all for this answer writing. Bye bye, take care, have a nice day.